And if, and I think you were in this. Were you in Beyond Computing?
Yes. Yeah,
okay.
Yes.
Great book. Have you ever read it?
Mm-mm.
Fantastic book. It's out, I think it's still in print, but if not, it's definitely available on Amazon. It's called Beyond Computing. It was put together at the 50th anniversary of the Association of Computing Machinery. And what they did, which was so brilliant, is they took people like John and said, okay, you guys built the first 50 years of computing. Now, you dream. What's the next 50 years look like? And the stories that are in there about where they wanted to take this. I mean, this is, I think Gilbert was gone by that time. I don't think he was in it. Maybe he was. But so many of these great names, some of whom nobody knows unless they're really in, deep inside of it. But you listen to them dream and you go, wait a minute, this is a 70-year-old guy who just took me about 500 years in the future. Because and you say, well, when did you start thinking about that? And they go, well, about 61. And it just blows you away. I was at the actual celebration. It was held in San Jose. Staggering. Just staggering. But I cannot recommend a work better to understand the difference between where we think we are today and where we could go and how we embrace. And Jobs is a great example, because if you really looked at his history of innovation, there's probably not much time that is ever spent from his mind in the subtleties and difficulties of packaging this and da-da-da-da-da. It's, let's take these ingredients and bring them together in something great. And I have to believe still to this day, maybe once a month, Bill Gates has to wake up in the morning and go, God, if I just could have talked better. Because when they went to visit Jobs and nearly bought the operating system, if the kids had not been recalcitrant, they'd been a little bit more cooperative, it would have been a completely different world for us, because I think it would have advanced us about 15 years in our thought process. But today we're in a situation to where what I spoke about, the intangibles, are now the great impacts. We've gone through four decades of trying to optimize cost, cut cost, figure out all sorts of new ways to do things faster, cheaper. That's been our mantra. And we've left all these other things on the table. And today we have to leverage technology to say, look, for example, just in the United States alone, let's be selfish for a minute. We're not growing anything like the rest of the world. We're not growing. We have a population that's nearly neutral. And so the question really is, what are we doing to optimize our world in such a way that we at least involve the decision-making related to intangibles with the same verve, with the same energy that we do the tangibles? So these new metrics I spoke about that are being worked on around the world to develop a whole new picture of how you gauge the value of a corporation, those are not just on the basis of figuring out a new way to invest or embracing the green kids or anything else like that. They're based on the fact that they carry with them the opportunity to drive a new mindset into the decisions that we make so that we are a minimum impact society on this huge situation we have going on in the world. There's a couple of real positives out of this. Here's a goofy one. We have water around the country in places where we could grow food, except the water is brackish, salty. So, for example, the entire western two-thirds of Kansas has plenty of water to grow food. But we can't because the water's brackish, and desal's too expensive. So we go get a couple of little small nuclear reactors, and we put desal plants there. And people say, well, yeah, but then I get to get the water to where it needs to go. Okay, how about we lose nature? Nature, it turns out, has actually dug little grooves in the ground called rivers. Now, some of them are full of water, some of them are empty. But they all have one characteristic. They all reach the lowest potential energy. That's why they flowed. So, how about I use flat pipe? Something you can buy in Denmark. Looks like this, not like that. Comes in different sizes. And you can roll it off the back end of a barge into a riverbed. Doesn't matter whether the river's full or empty. Now you have a way to get water at the lowest potential energy from A to B. Probably there's a city somewhere along there. And now you have a distribution mechanism to put desal water from aquifers that are completely unused into the middle of this country to become the biggest breadbasket in the world. and feed the huge populations that are growing in the emerging nations that they cannot feed because they do not have the tillable land. We're lucky in the United States, just because of odd geometry, we happen to be in a place where, because of the Gulf of Mexico and a couple other things, we have an enormous amount of tillable land. We don't do much of anything with it. If we were to simply spend an effort as a nation to look at the integrated picture, energy, water, food, world economy, allowing these populations to be sustainable because they can't do it on their own, what would that do? That's wide thinking. That's sitting down and looking at the big problems and backing up and looking at the tangential components. We're on, as a nation, we simply don't do it. As a people, I haven't found very many people to do it in any context.
You know, and the tools you're describing that let people see it, people will, if they see it, make the right decisions. But inherent in this idea of using the flow, the existing channels, the pathways for water, it adds resiliency. Yeah. Not only is it efficient, but we're in an increasingly turbulent world. In Africa, almost all agriculture is rain-fed.
Yeah.
And now the droughts and the torrential rains are becoming more and more intense. This is a continent at risk. And
yes.
A stable system that's resilient, as you described, that can provide the flow of water, all changing brackish water into utilizable water. Water, if we had to pick one area at this moment that's going to be the political and social determinant of war and peace, water is it. We're at this point today in this country where the existing infrastructure allows something like 20 or 30% to flow out through cracks and leaks and pipes. And
Detroit, the leakage is 41%.
It's just not, how could we say it, sustainable. It's not, and people when they, and so you don't see it because it's invisible. The tools that allow you to see it then allow you to decide how to change it.